Hello, welcome to Bite Size Med. This video is on the steps of cardiac muscle contraction. To understand cardiac muscle contraction, we need to know how a skeletal muscle contracts first, and then we compare. So in the next 2 minutes, I'm going to very quickly go over the steps of skeletal muscle contraction, just to give this video a little orientation. It starts at the neuromuscular junction. The action potential arrives, and acetylcholine is released. It acts on receptors on the muscle membrane. Sodium enters the muscle cell, and there's generation of an end plate potential. When that potential reaches threshold, there's an action potential. The action potential propagates along the membrane and down the T-tubules, which are dips from the membrane. That stimulates a dihydropyridine receptor, which is a voltage-gated calcium channel. This channel is mechanically coupled to a rhinodine receptor on the surface of the sarcoplasmic reticulum. When that channel opens, the stored calcium exits the sarcoplasmic reticulum and the intracellular calcium levels rise. The calcium then binds to troponin C, which is a part of the thin filament. This moves tropomyosin out of the way, allowing myosin to bind to actin. Myosin has ATPase activity. The energy from breaking down the ATP causes the myosin head to bend at the hinge region, dragging the thin filament along with it. The thin filament sliding inwards shortens the sarcomere, causing muscle contraction. There's a calcium ATPase pump on the surface of the sarcoplasmic reticulum. It pumps calcium back into the sarcoplasmic reticulum. This is the sarcoplasmic endoplasmic reticulum calcium ATPase, CERCA. Once the intracellular calcium levels come back down once again, the muscle relaxes. Now, cardiac muscle contraction is very similar to skeletal muscle contraction with a few differences. Unlike skeletal muscle, the impulse that tells the cardiac muscle to contract doesn't come from a nerve. It comes from the pacemaker of the heart, that's the sinoatrial node. That generates an action potential in the atrial and ventricular muscle fibers. The action potential in the contractile cells is different than how it was in skeletal muscle. There's a plateau during which calcium enters the cell. That is through a voltage-gated L-type calcium channel on the membrane of the T-tubules. Calcium ions move along their gradient entering the sarcoplasm, so the intracellular calcium concentration rises. But this calcium is insufficient to cause contraction on its own. What it does is it also triggers a calcium release channel on the surface of the sarcoplasmic reticulum. This is calcium-induced calcium release. So the calcium rising inside the cell has two sources: the extracellular fluid and the sarcoplasmic reticulum. The next series of steps is the same. Calcium binds to troponin C, and ultimately by the thin filaments sliding over the thick filaments, the sarcomere shortens and the muscle contracts. At the end of the plateau, the calcium influx is going to stop. Now what happens to the calcium inside the cell? The ions get pumped out of the sarcoplasm, back into the sarcoplasmic reticulum, and out into the extracellular space. The sarcoplasmic reticulum has a calcium ATPase pump that uses ATP and moves calcium against its gradient back inside the sarcoplasmic reticulum. This is the sarcoplasmic endoplasmic reticulum calcium ATPase type 2. The sarcoplasmic membrane, which is basically the plasma membrane of the cell, has a sodium-calcium exchanger. This moves sodium along its gradient, so sodium would enter the cell in exchange for calcium leaving the cell. So you can see how calcium gets out of the cell through this exchanger. That sodium is then going to be pumped out by a sodium-potassium ATPase pump. So the calcium level in the cell comes back down again, and when another action potential arrives, the process repeats. The tension that develops in the myocardial cell depends on the intracellular calcium concentration. This ability of the myocardial cells to contract and generate force is contractility. If there's increased calcium influx through the L-type calcium channels, there's going to be more intracellular calcium, so there's increased contractility. If there's increased calcium uptake into the sarcoplasmic reticulum, then there's going to be more calcium being stored, which can get released during the next contraction, again increasing contractility. This can happen with phosphorylation of these channels, which sympathetic stimulation does. Remember that the heart is supplied by autonomic nerves, the sympathetic and the parasympathetic nervous system. Sympathetic stimulation can increase contractility, so they're said to have a positive inotropic effect. Inotropism is the term that's used for contractility. So more contractility means it's a positive inotropic effect. Well, the parasympathetic system has the opposite effect. It has a negative inotropic effect. It reduces contractility more so in the atria than in the ventricles because they innervate the atria more. So like this, there are other factors which can either increase or decrease cardiac contractility. And this contractility, together with preload and afterload, are important factors that determine the stroke volume of the heart and thus the cardiac output. And that's how cardiac muscle contracts. If this video helped you, you can give it a like and subscribe to my channel. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.